Released back in 2012, Charles Murray's Coming Apart examines how and why white America has been drifting apart, forming two new and increasingly distinct classes. Drawing from David Brooks' analysis in Bobos in Paradise, Murray notes how the previously separate groups of bourgeois and bohemians have merged together. Previously, the bourgeois were the square, practical ones. They defended tradition and middle-class values. They worked for corporations and went to church. Meanwhile, the bohemians were the free spirits who flouted convention. But by the 1990s, everything had gotten mixed up. It was now impossible to tell an espresso-sipping artist from a cappuccino-gulping banker. The narrow elite includes the lawyers and judges who shape constitutional jurisprudence, the people who decide how the news will be covered on national news programs, and the journalists and columnists whose bylines are found in the leading print media and on the internet. It includes the top executives in the nation's largest corporations, financial institutions, foundations, and non-profit organizations. It includes the producers, directors, and writers who create the nation's film and television dramas, the most influential scholars in the nation's elite universities and research institutes, and senior government administrators and politicians. The narrow elite numbers fewer than 100,000 people and perhaps only 10,000 or so. Murray's criteria for the broad elite is to be within the top 5% of the managerial professions, so as to include all that could be reasonably thought to qualify and also include those that are borderline. He estimates that in 2010, about 2.4 million adults were members of this new elite, either individually or as a spouse. Murray demonstrates how this new upper class differs from the old establishment. As of 1960, the people who had risen up to the top had little in common except their success. The world in which David Rockefeller, the biggest name in the establishment, grew up could not have been more different from the world of the Jewish immigrants and sons of immigrants who built Hollywood and pioneered radio and television broadcasting. The men who were the leaders at CBS News in 1960 included the son of a farmer from North Carolina, Edward R. Murrow, the son of a Kansas City dentist, Walter Cronkite, who dropped out of college to become a newspaper reporter, and a Rhodes Scholar, Charles Collingwood. Dwight Eisenhower's initial cabinet was called Nine Millionaires and a Plumber, but only two of them had been born into affluent families. The others included two sons of farmers, the son of a bank cashier, the son of a teacher, and the daughter of the only lawyer in a tiny Texas town, and the son of parents so poor that he had to drop out of school to help support them. The Kennedy's administration's nickname was Harvard on the Potomac, but his cabinet was no more elite than Eisenhower's had been. Attorney General Robert Kennedy was rich and Harvard educated, and Treasury Secretary Douglas Dillon was a fully-fledged member of the establishment, but the others consisted of three sons of small farmers and the sons of a sales manager of a shoe company, the owner of a struggling menswear store, an immigrant factory worker, and an immigrant who made his living peddling produce. A narrow elite existed in 1960 as in 2010, but it was not a group that had broadly shared backgrounds, tastes, preferences, or culture. They were powerful people, not a class.
Really funny, makes me laugh. That's worth something.
I mean, it's true. He is basically this very nice person. But last night the argument was about where you sit in the movie theater. He says right brain people sit on the left, so now I'm not creative.
Yes.
I haven't said a word to him about his polyester shirts. Am I allowed to have a relationship with someone who wears polyester shirts?
They're not even blends.
This is 30-something, a a television series that first aired in September 1987. Murray identifies the program as one of the first attempts to portray this new culture. The culture depicted in 30-something had no precedent. With its characters who were educated at elite schools, who it discussed intellectually esoteric subjects, and whose sex lives were emotionally complicated and therefore needed to be talked about. The male leads were on their way up through flair and creativity, not by being organization men. The female leads were conflicted about motherhood and yet obsessively devoted to being state-of-the-art mothers. The characters all possessed a sensibility that shuddered equally at Fords and Cadillacs, ranch homes in the suburbs, and ponderous mansions. Budweiser and Chivas Regal. Murray identifies the university campus as the womb within which this proto-culture we now see all around us gestated. Murray was at Harvard from September 1961 until June 1965. He describes Harvard Square as different in some ways from Des Moines in Iowa, the city near the town where he grew up. Everybody in Cambridge seemed to drink their coffee with cream, whereas practically no one did in Des Moines. The Brattle Theatre was famous for its Bogart festivals during the reading period and had a little bar in the basement that probably didn't have a counterpart in Des Moines. The kiosk at the Harvard Square MTA station sold foreign magazines that couldn't have been bought in Des Moines. Just off the square was Cordullo's speciality shop that sold things like tinned pâté and Cadbury's chocolate, hard to get in Des Moines. There was live folk music at Club 47 on Mount Auburn Street, where Joan Baez had recently gotten her start. There were about 10 times more bookstores within a few blocks of Harvard Square than in the entire city of Des Moines. But that was about it. But this is not to say that the faculty and students of Harvard and MIT shared the same tastes and preferences as everybody else in Cambridge. Rather, there weren't enough of them to impose their will. They were a majority in only a few neighborhoods. A few years earlier, in the 1960 census, just 18% of the adults in Cambridge had college degrees, and Cambridge's median income was just $43,641 in $2010 dollars. In 1963, the Harvard Square had not yet begun to draw in young professionals who decided that they preferred Cambridge to the suburbs. The faculty and students of Harvard and MIT had not yet been reinforced by an influx of employees of high-tech industries and research organizations. Once you subtracted all the students, faculty, and university administrators living in Cambridge in 1963, most of the rest of Cambridge was a working class and lower middle class community. The latent propensity to create a different culture existed, but the intellectuals of Harvard Square didn't have the critical mass to reshape the community in the ways of that their tastes and preferences would reshape it when that critical mass materialized. The human impulse behind the isolation of the new upper class is as basic as impulses get. People like to be around other people who understand them and to whom they can talk. Cognitive segregation was bound to start developing as soon as unusually smart people began to have the opportunity to hang out with other unusually smart people. The yearning for that kind of opportunity starts young. To have exceptional cognitive ability isolates a young person as no other ability does. The teenager with exceptional athletic ability who becomes the star quarterback has lots of people who are eager to be his friends, even if he is shy or socially awkward. The teenager with exceptional interpersonal ability is one of the most well-liked kids in the school. That's what exceptional interpersonal ability does for you. But the math star who possesses only average interpersonal ability is seen as an oddball. He has just one or two classmates he can talk to about what he's good at, if he's lucky, and he may have no one at all. The teenage girl with average interpersonal ability and exceptional verbal ability has the same problem. If she has fallen in love with the poetry of T.S. Eliot, she is hard-pressed to find anyone else who will understand why. Her classmates already don't get her jokes and are put off by her vocabulary. She knows that if she were to try to talk about Ash Wednesday, she would at first get blank stares and then be teased unmercifully. This process is then reinforced by the increase in homogeny, the breeding of individuals with similar characteristics. Before the age of mobility, people commonly married someone from the same town or from the same neighbourhood of an urban area. The events that threw people together seldom had anything to do specifically with cognitive ability. Similar cognitive ability was a source of compatibility between a young man and a young woman, and some degree of cognitive homogeny existed, but it was a haphazard process. Meanwhile, educational homogamy was high, because hardly anyone went to college. In large proportions of married couples, both had less than a high school education, or both had a high school diploma. As the proportion of college graduates increased, so did the possibilities for greater educational homogamy at the top, as college graduates found they had more potential marriage partners who were also college graduates. Drawing on the extensive technical literature and the CPS, sociologists Christine Swartz and Robert Mayer examined trends in assortive marriage, as it is known in the jargon, from 1940 to 2003. They found that homogamy has increased at both ends of the educational scale. College graduates grew more likely to marry college graduates, and high school dropouts grew more likely to marry other high school dropouts. This table illustrates the huge increase in both percentage of inhabitants who are college educated, along with the rise in the median income expressed in $2010 dollars in well-known elite neighborhoods across the major cities of America. How important are these relatively few elite towns and urban neighborhoods? Hugely so, precisely because they are so few, and yet home to so many in the broad elite and to an even higher proportion of the narrow elite. Local freedom perpetually brings men together and forces them to help one another, in spite of the propensities which sever them. In the United States, the more opulent citizens take great care not to stand aloof from the people. On the contrary, they constantly keep on easy terms with the lower classes. They listen to them. They speak to them every day. That's not true anymore. As the new upper class increasingly consists of people who were born into the upper middle class families and have never lived outside the upper middle class bubble, the danger increases that people who have so much influence on the course of the nation have little direct experience with the lives of ordinary Americans and make their judgments about what's good for other people based on their own highly atypical lives. Many of the members of the new upper class are balkanized. Furthermore, their ignorance about other Americans is more problematic than the ignorance of other Americans about them. It is not a problem if truck drivers cannot empathize with the priorities of Yale professors. It is a problem if Yale professors, or producers of network news programs, or CEOs of great corporations, or presidential advisors, cannot empathize with the priorities of truck drivers. It is inevitable that people have large areas of ignorance about how others live. But that makes it all the more important that the members of the new upper class be aware of the breadth and depth of their ignorance. Murray posits four founding virtues of industriousness, honesty, marriage, and religiosity as the bedrock of early American life. Drawing heavily from Francis Grund's The Americans in Their Moral, Social, and Political Relations. Grund writes, "The American Constitution is remarkable for its simplicity, but it can only suffice a people habitually correct in their actions and would be utterly inadequate to the wants of a different nation. Change the domestic habits of the Americans, their religious devotion, and their high respect for morality, and it will not be necessary to change a single letter of the Constitution in order to vary the whole form of their government." Murray analyzes how durable these founding virtues have been in America since the 1960s by creating two hypothetical neighborhoods. The first is Belmont, where everybody has a bachelor's or graduate degree and works in high prestige professions or management or is married to such a person. And the second, Fishtown, where nobody has more than a high school diploma and everybody who has an occupation is in a blue-collar job, mid- or low-level service job, or some low-level white-collar job. Essentially, the top 20% and the bottom 30%. Murray then charts trends in what has happened to the founding virtues in both Belmont and Fishtown. In 1962, the Saturday Evening Post, the magazine with the Norman Rockwell covers, commissioned the Gallup organization to conduct a survey of the attitudes of American women. For the ever-married sample, whose opinions are reported here, Gallup interviewed 1,813 women aged between 21 and 60. "In general, who do you think is happier?" the Gallup interviewer asked. "The girl who is married and has a family to raise, or the unmarried career girl?" 96% of the wives said the married girl with a family was happier. 93% said that they did not, in retrospect, wish that they had pursued a career instead of getting married. What Murray finds that might surprise some is the vast divergence in the marriage rates between the fictional neighbourhoods of Belmont and Fishtown in the period 1960 to 2010. Having been 95 and 85% respectively in 1960, by 2010, marriage rates in Belmont had reduced slightly to 90%, but in Fishtown, they had plummeted to just 50%. The virtue of industriousness has also declined at a far more rapid rate in Fishtown compared to Belmont, with over 10% of prime age males in Fishtown not in the labour force, as opposed to around 3% in Belmont in 2010. Murray provides evidence that this is a trend that rises regardless of the national unemployment rate and is accompanied by a large increase in the people out of the workforce due to disability, from around 1% in 1960 to almost 8% in 2010. To examine honesty, Murray uses criminal statistics and charts the number of male prisoners per 100,000 population in Belmont and Fishtown between 1974 and 2004, when data was available. The same pattern emerges once again, with Belmont maintaining virtually insignificant numbers of male prisoners per 100,000, while in Fishtown, prisoners per 100,000 of the population went from around 200 to around 1,000. Murray also uses the measure of the number of bankruptcies per 100,000 as an indicator of honesty. Between 1960 and 2010, they increased by around 800%. While there has been a reduction in religiosity in both Belmont and Fishtown, it has been more pronounced in Fishtown. Murray categorizes people as de facto secular if they attend church once a year or less. Under this definition, the numbers of non-religious has risen to 40% in Belmont and over 60% in Fishtown. When we talk about classes, we reflexively resort to stereotypes. It is hard to think about the new white upper class without envisioning big houses with Mercedes parked under the porticos, or to think about the white new lower class without envisioning broken down cars rusting in front yards. But classes don't work that way in practice. The rich and the rednecks are mixed in with other people who qualify for the upper class or lower class, but are nothing like the stereotypes. This is especially true of the members of the new lower class. Most don't have anything obviously wrong with them. A better way to think about the new lower class is in terms of your own extended family or in terms of the stories your friends have told you about their families. At least a few relatives in those circles will be people who have never quite gotten their acts together and are the despair of their parents and siblings, even though they seem perfectly pleasant when you meet them. That's mostly what the new lower class involves. Individually, they're not much of a problem. Collectively, they can destroy the kind of civil society that America requires. If one adult man lives with his hard-pressed sister and her family, because he can't manage to hold on to a steady job, that puts a lot of stress on the sister's family. If many adult men in a community are living off relatives or girlfriends, that puts lots of stress on the community. A man who fathers a child without marrying the mother may be a nice guy who is sorry it happened, and he may be trying to do what he can to help out. But it remains true that only a small minority of unmarried men end up being fathers to their children. Children need fathers, and the next generation in a community with lots of children without fathers is in trouble. People who don't go to church can be just as morally upright as those that do. But as a group, they do not generate the social capital that the church-going population generates. It's not their fault that social capital deteriorates, but that doesn't make the deterioration any less real. The empirical relationships that exist among marriage, industriousness, honesty, religiosity, and a self-governing society mean that the damage is done, even though no one intends it. Murray is critical of attempts to create a European America and challenges the assumptions of the virtues of the welfare state. The tacit assumption of the advanced welfare state is correct when human beings face starvation or death by exposure. Then food and shelter are all that count. But in an advanced society, the needs for food and shelter can be met in a variety of ways, and at that point, human needs can no longer be disaggregated. The ways in which food and shelter are obtained affects whether the other human needs are met. People need self-respect, but self-respect must be earned. It cannot be self-respect if it is not earned, and the only way to earn anything is to achieve it in the face of the possibility of failing. People need intimate relationships with others. But intimate relationships that are rich and fulfilling need content. And that content is supplied only when humans are engaged in interactions that have consequences. People need self-actualization, but self-actualization is not a straight road, visible in advance, running from point A to point B. Self-actualization intrinsically requires an exploration of possibilities for life beyond the obvious and convenient. All of these good things in life, self-respect, intimate relationships, and self-actualization, require freedom in the only way that freedom is meaningful. Freedom to act in all arenas of life, coupled with the responsibility for the consequences of those actions. The underlying meaning of that coupling, freedom and responsibility, is crucial. Responsibility for the consequences of actions is not the price of freedom, but one of its rewards. Knowing that we have responsibility for the consequences of our actions is a major part of what makes life worth living. When the government intervenes to help, whether in the European welfare state or in America's more diluted version, it not only diminishes our responsibility for the desired outcome, it enfeebles the institutions through which people live satisfying lives. There is no way for clever planners to avoid it. Marriage is a strong and vital institution, not because the day-to-day work of raising children and being a good spouse is so much fun, but because the family has responsibility for doing important things that won't get done unless the family does them. Communities are strong and vital, not because it is so much fun to respond to our neighbours' needs, but because the community has the responsibility for doing important things that won't get done unless the community does them. Once that imperative has been met, family and community really do have action. Then an elaborate web of expectations, rewards, and punishments evolves over time. Together, that web leads to norms of good behavior that support families and communities in performing their functions. When the government says it will take some of the trouble out of doing the things that families and communities evolve to do, it inevitably takes some of the action away from families and communities. The web frays and eventually disintegrates. The problems these changes have engendered are different in kind from the problems of poverty. The problems that children suffer because of poverty disappear when the family is no longer poor. The problems that poor communities suffer because of poverty disappear when the community is no longer poor. The first two-thirds of the 20th century saw spectacular progress on that front. But when families become dysfunctional, or cease to form altogether, growing numbers of children suffer in ways that have little to do with lack of money. When communities are no longer bound by their members' web of mutual obligations, the continuing human needs must be handed over to the bureaucracies, the bluntest, clumsiest of all tools for giving people the kind of help they need. The neighbourhood becomes a sterile place to live at best, and at worst, becomes the Hobbesian all-against-all free-fire zone that we have seen in some of our major cities. Arnold Toynbee's Renaissance continues as Murray talks of the recognition of these trends he was describing in Toynbee's chapter Schism in the Soul from A Study of History, and how a creative elite has descended into a dominant elite. Murray's work has much similarity with the writings of Theodore Dalrymple in Life at the Bottom, published in 2001, and nothing has vindicated Murray's thesis as much as the political phenomenon of Donald Trump. Loved in Fishtown, hated in Belmont, Nothing illustrated the segregation Murray described like the response to his political career. Murray encourages the reader to reflect on their own experience to help recognise the proliferation of this new elite class. I feel that the changes Murray describes are happening throughout the Anglosphere, as the recent history of my hometown, which I will affectionately refer to as the Shire, illustrates. A town that was once a mixture of Fishtown and Belmont, but is now increasingly Belmont. Murray observes how the new upper class don't frequent bars with pool tables, bars that allow smoking, or bars with TV screens showing sports. In the Shire, there are four pubs. Growing up, three of them had pool tables, and two of them showed Sky Sports. Today, none of them have pool tables, and none of them show Sky Sports. And a four-bedroom home will cost you over £500,000, even though it's really just a Dino box with a bow on it.